The Vietnam War in the 60s and 70s split the country. While thousands of Kiwis fought there, thousands more at home marched against it. The feeling was so high, returning troops were told not to wear their uniforms to avoid protesters. But some of these soldiers had committed extraordinary acts of bravery, acts which their own country is still refusing to recognise. Here's Mark Crysell with the story of Victor Six Company and the lives that would change forever.
Vietnam. A war defined as much by those who fought against it as those who fought in it. Like Norm Fry.
I was a seventh generation professional soldier.
An officer in the New Zealand Army. But there's an incident that still haunts him.
It has nagged at me, and that's why I'm still doing it 46 years later.
Three soldiers who committed an extraordinary act of bravery that's never been recognised.
An injustice, do you think?
Oh, I think so, yes.
Some long overdue, yeah.
New Zealand sent around 4,000 troops to Vietnam between 1964 and 1972 to fight alongside the Australians. It was controversial, but the government was supporting America.
We shall begin a nobler war.
Who believed they could stop communism spreading through Asia.
Communist elements coming down into this part of the South Pacific.
I was young at the time and I was keen to get there and try out all the things that I'd been trained to do.
In 1971, Norm Fry was 24 and the infantry platoon commander of Victor Six Company.
Victor Six was a special company. It was a great privilege to actually command such well-trained and experienced soldiers.
New Zealand didn't conscript.
My mother wouldn't let me go because I was too young. Yeah, I was under 21, so in those days you had to be 21. But she did sign the papers in the end, yeah.
The time you got to Vietnam, it was like a class at school that had been together for a couple of years. You knew everybody intimately and you were all good friends. It was good.
Bill Papuni, Mike Williams, John Galley, comrades in arms, privates, mates. They were the boots on the ground, down and dirty.
It was hard work. We carried up to 100 pound of gear, whatever, is that 45 kilograms maybe, on our back. Always short of water, like just little sips every few hours kind of thing. Washing, shaving, cleaning teeth, that was just out of the question. So you'd go 6 weeks without doing any of that. Sleeping on the ground every night, obviously. Sometimes there was leeches, sometimes there wasn't.
John and Mike were also platoon medics.
If you got into a firefight or anything and anybody got injured, it was my thing to patch him up and give him first aid.
This photo of the three men was taken on the 25th of June, 1971. They're about to go into battle. Operation Hermit Park.
We'd been on operations for 14 days, patrolling and ambushing. We'd have a few light skirmishes with the enemy. And one of the New Zealand soldiers was killed.
A large North Vietnamese bunker system had been identified. Victor Six Company walked into the jungle behind a battalion of Australian Army Centurion tanks.
The tanks were bowling over trees, you know, and things like that, but they couldn't get through this bamboo.
The tanks were now exposed. Then, from nowhere, a rocket-propelled grenade slammed into the lead tank.
And it goes from silence to suddenly lots and lots of shooting and all hell breaking loose.
There's a yell come out about medic.
The Australian tank crew was seriously injured. Victor Six's Norm Fry and Lance Corporal John Adams were the first to get to them.
When we got to the turret, we could see that the crew were injured. At the same time, we could see some enemy moving from our left to our right.
The whole time, you were under fire.
The fire was coming into the tank.
Norm jumped off to take command of the firefight. Then, out of nowhere, Bill Papuni threw himself on top of the tank.
And he just jumped up, ran forward. I just looked at him, I thought, what the hell are you doing, man?
Under intense fire, John Adams and Bill Papuni started getting the first of the injured men out of the tank.
He was about 17 stone, this bloke. He was a big bloke. How Bill lifted him out, I don't know.
And then Bill went back and did it again with the next guy. And truly, that is just, there was no expectation for him to do it. He was not required to do it. We weren't even attached to those tanks.
The two badly injured Australians were passed down to Mike Williams and John Galley. John started working on the tank commander.
He was holding onto a machine gun when it was hit by the rocket, and his left arm was just meat to the, just below the elbow.
Mike was stabilising the second Australian who'd lost both his eyes and part of his head.
You can't really prepare yourselves for those situations until they arrive, but all the discipline and training you've had puts you in a position where you can cope with it.
They had to put their weapons down so they couldn't defend themselves. There were still rounds pinging off the turret of the tank. Loud noise, smoke and dust everywhere. It was quite hectic. I'd guarantee that the first aid that they applied to these guys saved their lives.
John Adams, Bill Papuni, Mike Williams and John Galley were all nominated for bravery awards for their actions that day by their boss, Norm Fry.
What they did was really gallant.
Shouldn't you have gotten one?
No, I was the platoon commander. I was there to do a job and lead these guys and lead by example.
But you were the first up.
Oh, well, it was natural. Being an ex-armoured corps officer, that was a sort of a natural reaction to just jump up there without thinking.
But there was also a catch. Kiwi troops fought in Vietnam under Australian command. Only they could award medals, and the Aussies had a quota.
I didn't think about me, but I thought Bill Papuni should have got one, definitely.
It's very, very clear in my mind that Bill Papuni saved those guys.
Only one, Lance Corporal John Adams, got the military medal for his brave actions. Privates Papuni, Williams and Galley got nothing.
It was a bit of a kick in the guts, I suppose for me personally, because I'd seen what these guys had done.
Norm Fry has never given up trying to have his soldiers' bravery recognised.
If I could have had a recording of it and shown it to the people who make the decisions, I think these guys would have got the highest awards they could have given.
When we come back, is it time New Zealand acknowledged the outstanding acts of bravery of Victor Six?
What would you like to say to his family? What would you like to tell them about him?
And 46 years later, a special meeting. The last of the New Zealand troops left Vietnam at the end of 1972. 37 of their mates had given their lives, failing to stop the spread of communism. Those who returned home weren't treated as heroes.
There was a lot of anti-war feeling. I mean, the war ended badly for the Allied forces. And of course, it wasn't a popular result. And I think a lot of soldiers carry that today.
It wasn't really a war they wanted to talk about anyway.
It didn't go down well, that you'd been in Vietnam. But then I went around and married a protester.
It's on my bucket list.
Hey?
Karen and John Galley have been married for more than 30 years.
So how do you stay clean out in the jungle?
You don't. You stay out there 6 weeks, but you can't smell each other because you're all smelling the same.
Mike Williams returned to the South Island when he left the army.
I'm a pretty low-key person at the best of times. I just got out of the army and went back to work.
They just got on with their lives as civilians. But both wondered what had happened to the men they'd rescued in the middle of that Vietnam firefight in 1971.
And that sort of built to the point where I really decided I wanted to know.
The last time Mike had seen Australian radio controller Phil Barwick, he was treating him for serious head injuries. In the mid-1980s, Mike rang a phone operator in rural New South Wales and found five Barwicks. He dialed one. A man came on the line.
And he said, well, that's my younger brother, Phil. He had gone home with those injuries and he'd lived for 17 years.
Phil Barwick returned to his Tamworth farm, married, and lived a full life despite being blinded by his injuries.
He'd passed away maybe 18 months before I made that call.
Mike visited the family. He's now very good friends with Phil's wife, Kath, and son, Rowan.
Phil, having survived that day, mainly due to Bill Papuni, allowed him to have a lovely marriage with Kath, produce a beautiful son. So yes, she's very, very grateful.
very grateful.
The other rescued Australian tank commander, Andy Anderson, passed away in April this year. He lost an arm in the incident and was looked after by John Galley.
We spoke to his wife, and she's just really grateful that he got extra years thanks to what you did.
I'm glad about that. Yeah. Very happy. Yeah.
The only member of Victor 6 awarded a medal for rescuing the Australian soldiers, Lance Corporal John Adams, passed away in 2003. He was 58.
I mean, I can look back and say at a comparable class photo from school or a kid's rugby photo team, you know, and there's not the same percentage of people that have died. You look at the platoon photo now and a good half of them are gone.
The toll of war. So what happened to Bill Papuni? Just after he left to fight for his country in Vietnam, his only child, Harriet, was born.
He was, funny, humble, pretty much spoilt me.
But when he was just 33, he died from stomach cancer. Harriet was 10.
The last time I saw him was at the hospital before he passed.
All she has left of him are photos and this letter to his sister.
Dear sis, sorry about not writing back to you.
Written just a week after he'd saved the lives of the Australian soldiers.
Well, I thought I'd better not talk about the actions in the jungle because it's terrible to talk about.
Did you know that he was a hero?
Was always a hero to me anyway, but yeah, I didn't realise he'd gone that far to risk his own life and to save others.
How does that make you feel?
Really honoured to be his daughter, yeah.
Norm Fry has travelled from his home in Australia to meet the daughter of the man he commanded.
That's the thing I crave the most, is people that knew my dad up close and personal. I just wanted to know what my dad was like.
I think any soldier who passes away before his time is due needs to be respected.
So Harriet,
mm-hmm.
This is Norman Fry.
She's brought her youngest son, Chance.
Does he look like his grandfather?
Oh, he certainly.
Does it take you back a bit?
Yeah. Your grandfather was a really respected soldier by the other soldiers. Apart from being a superb soldier, he was a real gentleman too.
He was very humble and funny. Yeah.
His actions were just nothing but gallant.
What would it mean to your family if you were able to get a medal for your father?
They'd all be very proud, They'd be very honoured and proud,
For 46 years, Norm Fry has prodded, poked and pleaded with the authorities, both here and across the Tasman.
Nice to meet you.
And just last year...
Today, as Minister for Defence Personnel, it is a great honour to be here.
A long campaign by Australian Vietnam vets convinced their government to retrospectively award gallantry medals to other soldiers who were overlooked.
The Australians have come back to us and told us that the Minister of Veteran Affairs would consider reviewing the case for an Australian award if it was recommended by a New Zealand politician.
But our government has changed the rules.
They've imposed a 5-year time limitation, which counts anybody out from Vietnam, of course. One of the politicians told us that if they this could set a precedent and there could be others.
June 25th, 1971, was a long time ago. And the three surviving eyewitnesses are humble men.
I know I did the right thing. I'm happy with it, yeah.
Lest we forget, they'll always remember the bravery of their mate, Bill Papuni, even if their country doesn't.
It was just huge. It was just huge. I mean, he put himself right up there at the worst possible time. It was amazing, truly. I really would love to see that recognised.
Any person that puts on a uniform for his country needs to be remembered and given the respect where it's due, and it's due for these boys.
Yes, so the Department of the Prime Minister and Cabinet initially said they'd be sticking to their 5-year limit and not consider an award. But late on Friday, Defence Minister Mark Mitchell told Sunday it's clear officials need to seriously look at the rules with a view to ensuring Defence Force staff can be recognised for acts of gallantry without being constrained by out-of-date rules. So, should our government recognise the bravery of Bill Papuni, Mike Williams and John Galley in Vietnam? Let us know. And TVNZ On Demand has just launched a 10-part documentary series called The Vietnam War. It's told from all sides of the conflict. You can find information on our Facebook page.